Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Human for Hire, Collateral Damage Included, by T.R. Harris, narrated by Keith Sellon-Wright. Chapter 1.
"Is that him?" Cannon asked.
Axa pulled the curtain back so he could also look out the window. He shook his head.
"I do not know. He appears much too small, and too young.
This one is but a child,"
Cannon grunted.
"Looks are deceiving," he said.
"Garrus at the spaceport recognized the species, and he would know. He has been well beyond the quadrant. He has seen them before."
Axa still wasn't convinced. He studied the slim creature, walking along the far side of the street, looking for further clues as to his identity. The alien was barely over three-quarters the height of the average Anarian, slight of build and with pale, almost sickly-looking pink skin. His eyes were blue. Yes, blue! And he wore a tight-fitting cap with a wide brim on his head. A set of goggles were fitted around the cap, resting on the brim, telling Axa that the stranger came prepared for the frequent sandstorms on this part of Anaria. He was dressed in a tan-colored short-sleeve shirt that was tucked into a pair of blue pants with pockets sewn mid-thigh. A strange location for pockets. Around his waist he wore a holstered MK handgun, but Axa couldn't make out what model. He continued to shake his head, doubting if this was the creature everyone had been talking about for months.
"You know their reputation," Cannon was saying. "It would be wise to exercise caution."
"The stories could be myths," Axa countered. "Self-created, to instill fear and respect wherever they go."
Cannon laughed nervously.
"It appears to be working, although I do not think they are myths. As you know, they once ruled the galaxy. That speaks to a particular set of skills few possess."
"Perhaps," said Axa, still not convinced. "But this thing is so tiny."
Cannon shrugged.
"Whether he is the one or not, we should still inform Jorvis. It is what he pays us to do."
Axa nodded.
"You are correct. I will tell him while you follow the alien. But not too close. You would not want to find out if the rumors are true about these creatures. These creatures called humans."
While Cannon set off to follow the human, Axa slipped out the back of the building and hurried along the next street, dodging the transports as they hurried by. He entered another building where two Anarians, seated at a table in the lobby, instinctively went for their weapons. They relaxed when they recognized Axa. One of the sentries nodded upstairs. Axa climbed the stairs and knocked on a door at the top of the landing.
"Come," said a voice from inside.
As Axa entered the room, he saw the gruff and solid figure of Jorvis Kanara seated behind his desk. On the other side were three other creatures.
"What is it, Axa?"
"An alien has come to town."
Jorvis chuckled and waved a hand at his guests. They were all non-Anarian and of various species.
"I should say you are correct. Please, my friends, forgive my associate. He has never been off Anaria."
Embarrassed, Axa nodded at the guests.
"My apologies."
Then he turned back to Jorvis.
"Garrus at the spaceport said this one is a human."
Jorvis and his guests tensed.
"Is it the same one?" Jorvis asked.
"Unknown. He has only just arrived." "Is the human here to reclaim the credits?" asked a purple-skinned creature with ears that reached to his shoulders. "We invested much making sure your operation on Xanor was successful. The credits are needed for the next phase of the operation."
Jorvis smiled and waved an impatient hand.
If this is indeed the same human who has been going about the quadrant apprehending people like me, then recovering any stolen credits would be one of his goals. However, my raids on neighboring Xanor have been going on for some time. They are a major source of funding for my syndicate. The recent theft on Xanor would be just another reason for the Xanorians to hire an agent such as the human.
Jorvis turned his attention to Axa.
Where is the alien now?
He is on Halfin Street. Kennan is following.
Then he will go to Yaffer's. All visitors go there. Inform Constable Linos as to the human's arrival, Jorvis said to Axa.
Then he turned and smiled again at his guests.
We will let the law on Anaria do to the human what the law on Xanor cannot do to me.
And then our visitor will find he has made a terrible mistake coming to my world. For on Anaria, there is no one more powerful than me. On Anaria, I am the human.
Adam Cain walked into the bar, temporarily blinded by the dim light inside. The place smelled of stale intoxicants and body odor, something one would expect on an arid world like Anaria. Through the gloom, he saw a dozen aliens, natives, all staring at him. This seemed as good a place as any to... He suddenly saw stars, and a moment later was tasting the bar's dusty and sandy wooden floor. As his mind quickly cleared, he recalled a split second before being hit as a boulder-sized fist slammed into the side of his head, coming at him from a darkened corner of the bar.
They do not seem so tough,
bellowed a foul-smelling wall of flesh, even bigger than the average Anarian. The square-headed creature was leaning over Adam, his four-foot-long arms built like tree trunks and arched at his side as fists clenched and unclenched.
Humans! No match for Anarians!
Adam heard someone in the bar yell out,
He is but a child, Kronos! It is not a fair fight!
Since when do Anarians fight fair?
The massive creature called Kronos bellowed again. Laughter erupted in the room. Adam propped himself up on his left elbow while rubbing his swollen jaw with his right hand.
I don't think I deserved that, he said to the towering Anarian. I only came here looking for information. I'm willing to pay for it.
In Jurian credits, perhaps? Kronos asked, pursing his thick lips. We use JCs to make decorative ornaments for our females. They are so colorful and worthless in the quadrant.
Your females or the credits?
Adam couldn't stop himself from asking.
The human has humor in his soul.
I also have energy credits.
How much?
What do you know?
About what?
About Jorvis Kanara.
Kronos grimaced as his massive head began to rock back and forth.
That, human, was the wrong thing to say. Mistake me not, I will still take your energy credits. But now I will kill you first.
Adam let out a deep sigh while thinking, Not again. In the blink of an eye, Adam lashed out with his right foot, sweeping the legs of the monster native. For such a tiny creature, Adam had more strength than expected. Kronos toppled over, hitting the floor just as Adam jumped to his feet. Then a powerful kick to the blockhead that would make an NFL field goal kicker envious was enough to put Kronos down for the count. But the fight wasn't over. Adam turned to see two other Anarians with their weapons drawn. He almost laughed, seeing the panicked looks on their faces as they stood, awkwardly, waiting for the targeting computers in the MKs to find a lock in the dim light. They could have simply trusted their aim and pulled the trigger, but that wasn't what aliens did. Well, most aliens, but not all. Being an alien himself, Adam didn't subscribe to the traditional way of firing a handgun. He pulled his MK-17 hybrid from his holster and sent two quick bolts center mass into the Inarians. Fortunately for them, the MK was set on level 3, the stun setting. But still, it was enough to have an impact on the others in the bar. They'd never seen anyone draw and fire so fast, and so accurately, without relying on the weapon's targeting computer. Hands quickly pulled away from gun stocks, diffusing the situation. That was until Adam was struck in the back with another stun bolt. For a human, a level 3 wasn't enough to stun them. But it was enough to knock Adam forward and back onto the floor. Then, three more hulking Inarians were on his back, pressing gun barrels into his side and disarming him. He was rolled over, staring up at a uniformed native wearing a satisfied grin.
"I am Constable Linos. I am the law in this town. I was informed that an alien with an attitude had arrived, one seeking to cause trouble." Linos looked over at the still unconscious Kronos, and then at the two stunned natives near the bar.
"I see, the information was correct. You are under arrest, with charges to be tallied later."
Adam was jerked to his feet, lost in a sea of 8-foot-tall natives who pulled his arms behind him and attached corded metal handcuffs to his wrists. From past experience, Adam knew the cords would be unbreakable, but the connections were vulnerable. But this wasn't the time nor the place for a demonstration.
"He was asking about Jorvis," someone in the bar yelled out.
Linos stepped closer.
"So I suspected. You should know, alien, that Inarians look out for each other. There is no law in the Quadrant except what can be enforced, and foreign law has no standing here. If you violate the rights of a citizen, then you will pay the consequences as deemed appropriate by me."
"I haven't done anything to Citizen Jorvis," Adam said in his defense.
"Ah, but you are wrong," Linos said with exuberance. "On Inaria, even contemplating an offense is a crime."
"You can read minds?" Linos looked around at the carnage in the bar.
"I do not have to. Any sane person can see that humans are a menace to everyone. Now, take him away. And human, you will find justice on Inaria is swift and final."
As Adam Cain was dragged from the bar, one thought kept rolling around in his head. "They don't pay me enough for this crap. Not even close." Chapter 2. After that, things went pretty much as expected. Adam was hauled into a police station not far from the bar and thrown into a cell with his hands still locked behind his back. He was hooked to a bar against the back wall as the three hulking deputies took turns pummeling him with their fists and alien bootjacks. It seems everyone had heard of the humans, and the Inarians were anxious to test their muscle and brawn on the supposed super-being. Adam went along for the ride, moaning and groaning where appropriate, eventually feigning passing out, hanging limply from the wall. The guards unhooked him but left the handcuffs on. Adam collapsed to the floor, moaning as he did. Constable Linos ordered his deputies out of the cell and then locked the door, placing the electronic key in his pocket. He stood on the other side of the bars for a moment before leaving the observation room. Adam climbed to his feet and sat on the end of the single cot in the cell. It was fairly beaten up, and blood oozed from his cut mouth. His body ached in a dozen places, even though that was changing rapidly. He surveyed his surroundings. The Inarians were serious about their detainment facilities. The metal bars were solid and joined by horizontal members every 10 inches, reinforcing the vertical rods. The alloy material would be strong, even as it was smelted to local standards. Adam already knew the gravity of Anaria was about three-quarters that of Earth, what was known throughout the galaxy as Jurian standard. The steel wouldn't be as strong as it would be on Earth. Even so, the way the cell was constructed would be problematic. Next, he looked at the back wall. He tapped it with his elbow, surprised to hear the hollow resonance of sticks and brick construction. Most cells Adam had been in were made of concrete block, if not metal. He grinned, knowing there were locally grown wooden studs behind the wallboard of this cell. Other than that, there was nothing else of interest in the cell or the observation area outside the room. All he had to do now was wait. And he didn't have to wait long. Soon, the constable returned with another native, which Adam recognized from the file he had back at his ship. It was Jarvis Kanara. The crime boss was larger than the average Anarian, more like Kronos than Linos, with the customary block head and yellow eyes. He wore an expensive silken overcoat of simmering blue and a long white scarf flung backward from his shoulders, forming a cape. He had an amused grin on his face.
"So, this is a human?" he asked Linos rhetorically. "They are much smaller than I imagined."
The native stepped up to the cell.
"I am Jarvis Kanara."
Adam remained seated. "Yeah, I figured. You got here fast."
"My headquarters is not far from here."
"Then I was right."
"About the location of my headquarters?"
"That you were. I operate out of the Tanis Fish Processing Center, but in reality, I control the entire city. Indeed, the entire district." "You smell like fish." Jarvis recoiled and then laughed.
"Yes, I do. You have a keen sense of smell."
"It's what we're known for." Jarvis shook his head.
"Not true, human. Supposedly you are a class of warriors rarely seen in the galaxy, much like the Jurians."
"We beat the Jurians," Adam said with a grin. "That makes us better than them."
"Huh, that is true," Jarvis roared. "I never liked the Jurians and I have never met a human before, but after the recent upheaval in the galaxy, both races are now mere side notes in history."
"With the Anarians destined to replace them?" Jarvis laughed again, shaking his head.
"My ambitions are much less grandiose. You can keep the galaxy. I will settle for the quadrant."
Adam grimaced. "You do know it's not really a quadrant. In fact, it's not more than a tenth of the galaxy, hell, not even that. More like a hundredth. But you can keep calling it the quadrant if it makes you feel more important."
Jarvis frowned and Constable Linos bristled. "He does carry a certain reckless attitude about him," Jarvis said to Linos.
"He is insane, that is what he is," said the police officer. "The arrogance of his race is evident, but he is living in the past. The humans are nothing now, and with only a handful of them even left in the remains of the expansion."
Jarvis shrugged. "That may be so, but this one has been causing quite the disruption within the quadrant."
He emphasized the word for Adam's benefit.
"He will no longer," Linos pointed out ominously.
"That is also true."
Jarvis leaned in closer to the bars.
"My friend, the constable, will soon pass judgment on you. He has that right. And what he will decree is what I tell him to decree. The mistake you made when coming here was to assume that not everyone in this part of Anaria was allied with me. They are. By coming here, you walked into the very center of my strength. Here, I am a world and you are but a person."
Jarvis turned away abruptly.
but now I have guests I must return to."
He looked at Linus.
"As entertaining as this event has been, I now grow weary. The human is a disappointment. You may do with him as you wish. I will record this meeting as a revelation that the reputation of the mighty humans is but a myth, a fantasy, and that any past glory they may have once enjoyed is long gone."
He looked back at Adam. "I was so hoping for more of a challenge. Life grows boring when you sit atop the pinnacle, the master of all you survey." Adam said nothing. Instead, he simply winked. The native frowned, not knowing how to take the gesture. It was not what he expected from a being about to be executed. No, it wasn't. And that was because Adam Cain had no intention of being executed. Linus returned a little later, his face glum.
"I am in a quandary," he announced to his prisoner.
Adam got up from the cot and walked to the bars, his hands still clasped behind his back.
"Of course, I will kill you, or more correctly, I will have you killed. My problem is I do not want to waste the opportunity of killing a human on some mundane method, one used on hundreds before you. I need to make your death an event."
Adam laughed. "So you've come to me for advice? Sorry, I can't help you, except to say this. I'm not going to die here."
Linus recoiled slightly. "You are not. Then that is news to me."
"It always is for my capturers."
"And why are you so confident that I will not kill you?"
"Consider, Constable Linus, I have been operating in the quadrant for 6 months, and I have made 19 apprehensions of fugitives or those sought by various private or government interests. Do you think that in all that time only you and Jorvis have been able to catch me? Is your organization so much better than any of the others?"
"What is the point you are trying to make?"
Linus looked worried, even though he was on one side of the cell door and Adam was on the other. "Ask yourself, why was I so easily captured?"
"It was fortuitous. I came at you from behind. You were distracted by others in the bar."
Adam nodded.
"That makes sense. If this were the first time I'd been in that situation. Honestly, I have been in similar situations hundreds of times throughout my life."
Linus laughed. "Now, I know you are lying. You are too young to have had so many experiences."
"I'm a lot older than I look."
"Which means what?"
"Never mind. It's not important at the moment."
"Are you telling me you intended to get arrested?" Adam's face lit up.
"Bingo!"
"Meaning you're right," Adam said before the translation bug screwed up the word bingo.
"That's exactly it."
Behind his back, Adam worked the handcuffs, twisting them at the connecting joints between the clasps and the braided cord holding them together. The metal was bending. Linus shook his head, scoffing at the concept.
"Then you truly are insane. Why would you do such a thing?"
"Simple. When I'm in here and you're on the other side of the bars, you're a lot more willing to talk, to give me the information I need. And if your intention is to kill me, you'll tell me everything, thinking what harm could it cause. That's exactly what happened here. Jorvis came in and told me where to find his headquarters. I've been on planet for about 2 hours, and I already know where I have to go to get my bounty. Thank you very much for helping me, Constable."
Linus waved his hand. "This is nonsense. Even if we gave you information, you have no way of acting on it."
"Then you won't mind telling me where my weapon and documents are that you took from me." He spoke loudly to disguise the subtle snap of the handcuffs. Linus was troubled by Adam's confident tone, but he wasn't about to give in now.
"They are in my office," he stated defiantly.
northwest corner. There, now you have more information which you cannot act upon."
Adam bowed his head slightly, resting his forehead on the metal bars of the cell. He whispered something that Linos didn't hear clearly.
"What did you say?"
He leaned in closer to the cell.
And that's when Adam reached out through the bars with his now free left hand and grabbed Linos by his thick neck. He pulled the huge block head against the bars, while bringing up his right hand holding a 3-inch-long piece of connecting metal from the handcuffs he'd just broken. He pressed the rod against the constable's neck.
"I said, thanks, now I can leave."
He jabbed the makeshift knife into the soft skin under the chin, grinding it in, looking for one of the arteries that supplied blood to the brain. All prime beings had such arteries. It was just a matter of finding it. Blood gushed from the wound, bathing Adam in the red alien liquid. He spit when some of it entered his mouth. He held Linos against the bars until the trembling body fell still. Then he gently lowered him to the floor. Adam quickly rifled through the officer's pockets, searching for the keys to the cell. He put the control device in his pocket when he left with Jorvis. But now it wasn't there. Adam panicked. Then he looked across to a table set against the far wall of the observation room. A datapad was there, along with a rectangular device about the size of a garage door opener. It was the key to the cell, and it was about 12 feet on the other side of the bars. Shit, Adam thought. Now what? He grasped one of the bars and braced his feet against another. Then he pulled with all his human strength. As expected, the metal bent slightly, but the reinforcing crossbars kept the opening from expanding enough to make a difference. Adam spun around and looked at the back wall of the cell. He knew from the layout of the building that this was an exterior wall, with freedom on the other side. He ran over and moved the cot away. He tapped gently so as to not attract the attention of the other officers in the building. He found a hollow area, and then, using his body to help muffle the sound, slammed his elbow into the wall. The wall board broke a little. He hit it again, opening up a larger section that he could get his hands into. Desperately, Adam tore at the wall, pulling away larger and larger sections of wallboard until he had 3 of the vertical studs revealed. On a light gravity world such as Anaria, cellulose material did not have to grow as tight and rigid as it would on a heavy gravity planet like Earth. And with lighter loads to carry, the wood was lighter and more brittle, almost like balsa wood. Adam slipped his shoulder between 2 of the studs and pushed. He was rewarded when the boards split easily, opening a space large enough for him to crawl through. Next, he had to get through the outer layer of the wall, and this was made of native brick. There was insulation to be pulled away before Adam could see the inner side of the exterior wall. He stepped back and placed a solid kick onto the surface. Nothing. Then a second kick, and a third. The mortar between the bricks began to crack, and 2 more kicks was enough to open a space about 1 foot square. That was all it took. The weakened wall gave way when Adam stepped back and then crashed his body sideways into the barrier. He tumbled out onto a concrete sidewalk lining a fairly busy road bordering the police station. 12 Anarians noticed and stood gawking at the short alien who just crashed through the wall, now covered in red and white dust and lying on a pile of crumpled brick. If any realized he'd broken out of the police station, they didn't show it. Although they were surprised and possibly in shock, none of the 8-foot-tall natives seemed scared. At 6-foot-tall, Adam wasn't that imposing of a figure, appearing almost like a hobbit to the natives. Adam didn't waste time. He was free, but he wasn't ready to leave.
He sprinted around the side of the building to the entrance of the police station. When he was brought in, he noted the location of the doors and the layout of the lobby. He also counted the police officers he saw. There weren't many, but he had no idea how many there were in the bullpen or the side offices. Still, he couldn't leave without his weapon, his ID, and most importantly, the keys to his spaceship.
Adam pressed open one side of the double doors and slipped inside, crouching to stay hidden in the visual shadow of the 6-foot-tall counter that greeted visitors to the station.
An officer was on the other side, working a data console, and didn't notice the opening door. Beyond him was the bullpen, where the rank-and-file police officers worked. Adam made it to the base of the counter, and then slid to the side, looking around into the large room beyond. Three other officers, two of which he recognized from the beating he'd taken earlier. This could be fun, getting a little payback. Beyond the bullpen was a line of private offices for the senior personnel. The layout was eerily familiar to any number of municipal offices one would find on Earth. Prime beings, humanoid to humans, all had similar wants, needs, and desires, which meant their buildings, clothing, and mannerisms were universal, with only slight variations. It made working within the galaxy easier. Not easy, but easier. Adam sized up the competition. Besides the native at the counter, there were 3 more in the bullpen, plus 3 others who appeared to be civilians. They didn't wear uniforms and were engrossed in their computer screens. Adam would deal with them if he had to. His goal was the large office at the northwest corner, the office of the captain of the precinct, or, in this case, the constable. Adam moved back until he was directly below the officer on the other side of the counter. Then, taking a deep breath, he crouched, firmed his muscles, and jumped. In the light gravity, Adam's human muscles were enough to send him over 6 feet straight up and onto the top of the counter. The startled Anarian dropped his jaw and froze momentarily, long enough for Adam to take him out with a powerful kick to the chin. Then, before the others in the bullpen could react, Adam braced his feet against the inner side of the counter and jumped, his arms outstretched like Superman, and directly into the back of the closest uniformed officer in the room. He was seated at a desk, and the force of Adam's body slammed him into the desktop, fracturing ribs and collapsing his lungs. Adam was moving before the native gasped his last breath. He was on the floor now, dodging between desks and closing fast on one of the officers who had beat him silly only half an hour before. Already, most of Adam's injuries were healed, including the cut on his lip. He'd let the Anarians believe he was hurt more than he was, having learned that acting defiant and semi-immune to such beatings only led to longer and more intense sessions. His next target was also one of his attackers. The native saw him coming and went for his weapon. Adam recognized it as an MK-24, a mid-range model between the ubiquitous 17 and the more advanced 47. Adam had no idea what default setting it would be set at, but even at level 2, although it wouldn't kill him, it would slow him down enough for the other officer to join in. Adam threw his legs out in front and slid on the smooth, polished floor. He took out the legs of the much larger native, interrupting his aim. Even so, like most aliens, he would rely on the targeting computer, unless he panicked. Adam had seen that, too, where an alien started shooting indiscriminately. Alien aim was often atrocious, but sometimes they got lucky. Adam and the native now tangled together, with the much smaller human enmeshed in a forest of 20-inch-thick arms. Fortunately, size didn't matter on a light-gravity world. In fact, the lighter the gravity, the bigger and weaker the natives. Without the constant pull of heavy gravity, plants and animals tended to grow taller but less robust. Bone density was less, and flesh often softer. This was the case with the massive Anarian. Adam locked a human arm around a matching native limb and pulled. A pronounced crack was heard as the police officer let out with an ear-piercing scream. He released Adam, more concerned with how his arm was now bent at a 90-degree angle and not at the elbow than he was with the human. The next native lawman-like thing had his weapon out and aimed at Adam. The light at the building was much brighter than in the bar, so the targeting computer would have no issue acquiring a target. The problem? It would take about half a second to lock in at this range. That was long enough for Adam to dive to his right to avoid the first plasma bolt. He slipped behind a desk, which would disrupt the computer, requiring another lock once the target was reacquired. Crawling on his hands and knees, Adam moved between desks, hearing the last surviving officer yelling to the clerical workers in the room to call for backup. Out of the corner of his eye, Adam saw the civilians running for the exits, not wanting to get involved. Maybe once out of the room they would follow the orders. But for now, they didn't want any part of what was happening. The officer was rushing between desks, trying to get a bead on Adam. He fired again, this time without a target lock. He missed, but it told Adam he couldn't take any chances with this guy. He was either too scared or too angry to follow normal alien firing protocols. Adam came upon a table instead of a desk, allowing him to slide underneath. He pushed off a desk and slid on the floor, coming up parallel to the mad officer a row of desks over. The native saw him, but not in time. Using his human speed, Adam was up and across the dividing desk in a heartbeat. The two came together, a massive but weak creature against a smaller but stronger and more dense human. Adam grasped the thick wrist of the hand holding the MK. In turn, the Anarian grasped Adam's hand with his left and lifted both his arms and Adam high above him. 4-foot-long arms, combined with a standing height of 8 feet, put Adam 11 feet in the air, taller than a basketball hoop. He dangled there as the native police officer fought to keep control of the weapon. He was yelling and growling, sounding more like a wild animal than a civilized prime. He swung Adam around, sending his legs crashing into the sides of desks. That's when Adam gave up trying to get the gun. His right hand was still locked around the native's wrist and unable to get free because of the second hand clamped around his. That still left Adam's left hand free. He flattened the palm and then sent his stiffened fingers into the throat of the alien police officer. The impact was powerful and penetrated 3 inches into the flesh, making a profound impression on the towering native. Both his hands now moved to his crushed larynx, dropping the gun and forgetting about the diminutive alien he'd been fighting. Adam fell hard to the floor, but was on his feet a moment later. The officer was now on his knees, writhing in pain and gasping for breath that refused to enter his lungs through his crushed windpipe. Adam recovered the MK, and feeling sorry for his victim, placed a bolt directly into his head. The ball of white-hot energy melted the brain, which then quickly expanded, causing the skull to explode. For the second time in half an hour, Adam was bathed in alien blood, but now with gooey gray matter in the mix. Adam scanned the room. It was empty, although he heard a siren wailing from somewhere. His presence in the police station was no longer a secret, and soon every officer in the area would be on their way. Focusing on the corner office, Adam ran to it, bursting through the door. He looked around, finding his belongings sitting atop a cluttered wooden desk. With a sigh of relief, Adam scooped up his leather holster and wrapped it around his waist. He pulled out the hybrid weapon and checked the charge on the energy function. When Adam began his new life as a gun for hire, he modified the standard Maris Kliss handgun to include not only an energy aspect, but also a ballistic capacity, meaning he added a barrel, receiver, and magazine holder for a 9mm human handgun. Bolt launchers were fine if you had the battery capacity and weren't over 100 yards away. Adam preferred metal slugs to balls of energy, though both had their advantages. Ballistics could blast through barriers and had much longer range. But out here in the galaxy, finding a reliable ammo supply was the issue. On the other hand, energy weapons could be recharged indefinitely. Their disadvantage? They had limited range, no penetrating power, and limited capacity per charge. But the supply of charges was unlimited. And that's why Adam decided to combine the two weapons systems into one deadly device. It was bulkier than either weapon alone.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.